Hi folks. In this module, we'll continue our look at the synthesis and structure of macromolecules, focusing here on nucleic acids. Afterwards, we'll tackle the concept of specific versus non-specific macromolecular interactions that are really crucial to cell structure and function. This slide is just a reminder of the differences between RNA and DNA nucleotide monomers. Nucleotides consist of the bases adenine, uridine, cytosine, and guanine in RNA, and adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine in DNA. Let's show these on the slide. There you go. Also, there's a 5-carbon sugar, ribose in RNA, and deoxyribose in DNA, and one or more phosphates. You're looking here at nucleotide monophosphates. Now, these monomers are linked in condensation reactions to form either RNA or DNA. As you can see from this illustration, the nucleotides in a nucleic acid are linked by phosphodiester bonds, or more appropriately, phosphodiester linkages, the result again of condensation reactions. Note here that a nucleic acid has directionality. We say it has a 5' prime and a 3' prime end. The 5' prime end refers to the nucleic acid with a free phosphate group on the 5' prime carbon of the sugar. That's shown at the top here. The 3' prime end refers to the free hydroxyl group on the number 3 carbon of the sugar at the other end. Now this is RNA. How do I know this? By convention, we will write nucleic acid sequences in the 5' prime to 3' prime direction. The ability of bases to form H bonds is, of course, the basis of the formation of secondary structure in RNA or the formation of the double helix. The ability of the bases in nucleotides to form hydrogen bonds, along with other evidence, led Watson and Crick to propose that DNA was actually a double strand of nucleic acids. We know now that A normally forms 2H bonds with T, and C forms 3H bonds with G in a double helix. But the potential of the bases to exist in different shapes, or tautomers, with different H bonding potential, made building the model of DNA, or the DNA double helix, interesting to say the least. So here are two views of the DNA double helix. The left image emphasizes, of course, the base pairing, showing AT and GC combinations, while the space-filling model, shown at the right, highlights the shape of the double helix. Now, the double helix includes a so-called major groove and a minor groove. Can you recognize which groove is which? And do you remember their functional significance? The double helix exists because it's held together by millions of hydrogen bonds that, while individually weak, act in concert to maintain a stable structure. We'll return to a consideration of the structure and functions of nucleic acids and proteins as well several times in this course. Here, I want to highlight the fact that non-covalent interactions, like the millions of H bonds between strands in DNA, can form within and between different molecules, creating very stable shapes. We saw this in the three-dimensional structure of polypeptides, represented by the cartoon on the left, and in the folding of a single strand of RNA, represented by the drawing on the right. Given the huge number of hydrogen bonds or other non-covalent interactions within and between large, that is to say, macromolecules, it really shouldn't come as a surprise that there are alternate possible interactions and alternate ways of folding a molecule, and therefore, in fact, isomeric shapes that could form. The cartoon here illustrates the concept of one more stable shape, or set of non-covalent interactions, accumulating in a cell or in a test tube among many less stable ones that fold or unfold due to thermal motion. The more stable molecular interactions are the specific ones. It's the specific interactions that lead to appropriate or correct biological function. Here, A, B, C, and D are generic macromolecules. The AB and AC interactions involve only a few bonds. in part because the shapes of the interacting molecules are not very fitted, or we say complementary. But check out the good fit in the shapes of molecules A and D. The complementary shapes permit a close approach of the two molecules to each other, maximizing the possibility for mutual attraction. For example, by H-bonding or the attraction of opposite full or partial charges. The AD interaction is strong and more able to withstand the thermal motion expected at cellular temperatures because the strength of the multiple bonds is in fact additive. We say then that the AD interactions are specific, while the weaker AB and AC interactions are non-specific. Specific interactions, such as those cartooned here, are responsible for the precision of enzyme catalysis, hormone function, and even structures of and within cells. Strength in numbers. Let's follow the assembly of rough endoplasmic reticulum in this slide as an example of productive macromolecular interactions. First, of course, monomeric subunits like the amino acids here and nucleotides are polymerized in dehydration synthesis reactions to form polymers that fold into specific shapes. The resulting polypeptides and RNAs bind specifically to each other, actually in a very precise order, to form ribosomal subunits in an active macromolecular assembly. The ribosomal subunits meet up with an RNA molecule and start making polypeptides, and some of these attached to internal cellular membranes to form the rough endoplasmic reticulum, yet another act of macromolecular assembly. Again, the point here is that many large cellular structures form specifically in this way. I want to leave you with some observations about ATP. Of course, ATP is one of the four precursors to RNA synthesis, becoming AMP when part of the chain. But recall that free energy from sunlight, or more directly from food, is used to make ATP. The energy in ATP, in particular in the phosphoanhydride bonds shown here, is then used to do cellular work. Here's the fascinating question. When and why were nucleotides selected as both the precursors to information molecules and as carriers of chemical energy? Was it a prebiotic selection, something that actually happened before the first cell formed in the prebiotic soup? Was the selection simultaneous, or was ATP an energy molecule first, and only later an informational one, or vice versa? Answering these questions, or attempting to answer these questions, should lead you to interesting speculations about what the first cells may have looked like in terms of information and energy storage and retrieval. And so, we end this presentation.